that takes us to our final case for the morning, 350 Montana versus Bernhardt. Counsel for appellant, please proceed.
Good morning, Your Honor, and may it please the court. Shiloh Hernandez for appellants. I intend to reserve 5 minutes for rebuttal, and I will watch the clock. Your Honors, the Office of Surface Mining's approval of the 7,000-acre expansion of the Bull Mountains Mine that will cause approximately a quarter billion tons of greenhouse gas emissions was unlawful and should be vacated. To demonstrate why, I will address 3 points this morning. First, OSM failed to evaluate the actual environmental impacts of this quarter billion tons of greenhouse gas emissions, and instead placed its thumb on the scale by disclosing project benefits while zeroing out the even greater impacts of the greenhouse gas emissions.
Counsel, second, can I ask you about that first argument? Because you quote heavily this thumb on the scale language that comes from CBD. But that language was in the court's analysis of the EPCA claims, not in the NEPA claims. And EPCA actually does have some analysis requirement of cost, whether it's cost benefits, of some cost implications there. Do you have a NEPA case? Because NEPA and EPCA are different statutes. Do you have a NEPA case that says that you have to use cost benefit analysis? Because everything I've read suggests that you specifically don't use cost benefit analysis in a NEPA case.
That's, Your Honor, the relevant rule and the reason that the CBD case is applicable here is that NEPA itself at 4332 subsection B requires a balancing of cost and benefits. It doesn't necessarily have to be a mathematically established cost benefit analysis. But the language in the statute, as interpreted by the Ninth Circuit in the Columbia Basin case and subsequent cases, have said that NEPA, the language of NEPA, requires a balancing of costs and benefits. Moreover, the language of the term of the statute, as interpreted by the courts, is that that balancing has to consider environmental effects on equal basis. That's the language of this court, on equal basis with environmental costs. So,
my point. I think you're proving my point. It requires environmental effects. It doesn't require a financial cost-benefit analysis, which ECBA does. So I feel like you're raising this argument and trying to transfer language that was adopted in CBD under ECBA, a substantive statute, into a procedural statute under NEPA. And that's why I'm asking, is there a case under NEPA, and maybe you're citing the Columbia Basin, maybe that's your position, but is there a case in the Ninth Circuit that says that cost-benefit, financial cost-benefit analysis has to be done under NEPA?
There's not a Ninth Circuit case that says it always has to be done. The Columbia Basin case says sometimes if there's not another way of adequately comparing costs and benefits, it may have to be done. That's Columbia Basin. There are numerous district court cases that say the same reasoning used in CBD applies in NEPA when you have an unbalanced comparison of costs and benefits. That's the High Country Conservation Advocates case, the MEIC case from 2017, the Wild Earth Guardians case from the District of Montana from this past year, California versus Bernhardt, Northern District of California from last year, and most recently our 28J letter on the District of Utah case, Utah Physicians for a Healthy Environment. They all agree with us that the same analysis occurs, and in order to avoid the misleading comparison of costs and benefits, which numerous courts have said, from the Sigler case in the Fifth Circuit to the Hughes River case in the Fourth Circuit to the Johnston case, which I'll return to in the Tenth Circuit. An agency in conducting its NEPA analysis cannot leave the public and decision makers with an analysis that's misleading. And by not disclosing known quantifiable environmental costs that would materially affect the consideration of costs and benefits, that is misleading and unlawful. Final point on this.
So now let me hit you up on the known benefits and costs. You've submitted that they should have used the social cost of carbon test. Is that the best scientific evidence out there as to what the cost and of what the potential costs of global warming would be?
In this case,
of a specific project.
In this case, Your Honor, it's the only methodology out there, and the methodology used by the Office of Surface Mining is not based in any science. All they did was compare project emissions to global totals. And that analysis, we know, Your Honor, from the CBD decision, violates NEPA because it tells decision makers and the public nothing about the actual incremental impacts of the project's emission. The Fifth Circuit did a very good job of illustrating this in the SWEPCO
decision. But just to clarify, so your position is they need to go into a more granular analysis. And in your opinion, the only analysis that would work is the social cost of carbon. Is that correct?
Our two responses, Your Honor. Our first point is that they have to at least conduct a non-arbitrary analysis. And under CBD, just comparing project emissions to global total is arbitrary. That alone undermines OSM's analysis. Second, NEPA regulations that were in place at the time, that's 40 CFR 1502, 22, and 23, so the agency has to have some scientifically based methodology for making its determinations. Here, there is no other methodology identified in this record other than the social cost of carbon that's available to the agency. The agency's decision to not use it was arbitrary. The agency offers two explanations in its brief for not using the social cost of carbon, neither of which has merit. First, the agency says the social cost of carbon doesn't analyze the actual incremental impacts of GHG emissions. That's wrong, Your Honor. The agency cites no scientific authority for that proposition, and the record disproves it. Therefore, the agency's excuse runs counter to the evidence in the record and is therefore arbitrary under the State Farm line of cases.
Is there a case, because I mean, this is a big issue, and it comes up in a lot of contexts of how do you determine what the environmental effects of a single project would be? And it seems like the scientific consensus is you can't do that on a project by project basis, but you're pointing to the social cost of carbon. How does that show it on a project by project basis when you're ultimately analyzing what 0.04% of the worldwide carbon emissions?
That exactly, great point, Your Honor. And that's one of the reasons the agency's analysis here was wrong. The agency said there's no way to analyze project-specific emissions. We can't do it. That's simply wrong on this administrative record. This administrative record shows, and we cite it in our briefs, that the social cost of carbon does, in fact, model the actual incremental impacts of greenhouse gas emissions from individual projects.
But can you explain to me how it does that? Because, I mean, this is the whole problem with global warming, is that you're making a huge amount of assumption about what the worldwide global emissions will be. Those could go up, those could go down, and depending on how far they go up or how far they go down over the years, has a radical impact on what that incremental cost would be. And so that seems to be what the agency said here, is it doesn't make sense when you get a range of, I don't remember, I apologize, 3 billion to 32 billion. Like, how do you pick a number out of there? It's just inherently unreliable.
2 points, Your Honor, in response. First, with respect to how the social cost of carbon works, in brief, it takes a model of global climate and then analyzes the impacts of GHG emissions to that, and then runs that through a global macroeconomic model to get the monetization. It's an extremely detailed and rigorously evaluated process that has been supported by literally thousands of researchers and decades of peer-reviewed science. It's robust. There's no evidence in the record showing that it's not reliable in any way other than underestimating the cost. Second point, and that's that this range argument that the agency offers, that it's not reliable because the social cost of carbon uses a range of values, was rejected specifically by this court in the CBD decision, where the court said, even though there is a range of values, there's no question that the value is not zero. And here, using even that lowest figure that you just cited, Your Honor, $3 billion shows that...
Well, let's go back to CBD, because CBD, that seems to me to be a different case, because CBD, there was nothing in the record. Here, the agency seems to have capitulated, if you will, and acknowledged that there's going to be a huge cost, or at least pretty significant harms, environmental harms and other harms that are going to come from global warming. It's the quantification that becomes difficult. And I think that's where CBD never said you had to quantify it in the granular level of detail. Now, maybe you need to, but that issue wasn't before the court in CBD.
Well, CBD did, with respect, Your Honor. CBD said that just doing what was done here, comparing project emissions to global totals, is not enough. They said, that's not enough. You have to look at the actual incremental impacts. And that's just what the social cost of carbon said here. And
counsel,
I think, Your Honor, this is a good
counsel,
point where we can—
Counsel.
I'm sorry, yes, Your Honor?
I'd like you to assume, forgive me for interrupting, but I'm trying to get in a word edgewise.
Yeah.
I would like you to assume, for purpose of this hypothetical, that we don't think the agency was required to use the social metric that you're suggesting. Mm-hmm. And it seems to me, though, that they do have to have some metric. I'd like to talk about if they were within their discretion to decide not to use that metric. What's wrong with the metric they used?
That's, and Your Honor, that is our argument. Even if you don't have to get to the social cost.
So could you please make it? Could you focus on that, please?
Here, the agency makes this analysis, Your Honor, and they say the project emissions from this mine expansion will constitute 0.4% of global emissions, and therefore they are minor and insignificant. They cite zero actual scientific evidence to support that conclusion. In that circumstance, they're not entitled to any deference, and their reasoning is arbitrary for this reason, Your Honor. First, they don't get deference because they cite no science to support that reasoning. And second, per this court's decision in the Liberty Oil case, they don't have expertise in climate change or environmental economics, so they're not entitled to deference with respect to assessing significance of environmental of greenhouse gas emissions. Second, with respect to that analysis, and that goes to my second point, Your Honor, the question about whether or not they should have prepared an EIS. Their analysis was it's not significant because it's a small fraction of global totals. That reasoning, without considering the social cost of carbon, has been specifically rejected by this court. And that's what the court said in CBD. And the point that
Wait,
I'd like
where,
to
where has that to, argument been rejected? You mean CBD?
In CBD, yes. CBD versus NHTSA decision.
Well, but CBD didn't address the social cost of carbon. So how do you say
that's
that?
That's what I'm saying, Your Honor. Setting aside the social cost of carbon, just the assessment of the significance of greenhouse gas emissions, CBD said that you can't, an agency can't just say this is a small fraction of a global total and therefore significance. Citing Judge Wald's decision in the 1992 NHTSA case, the court said there has to be some scientific basis to support a determination of non-significance.
And other than social carbon cost, what is that scientific basis?
That's what's missing here. Here, there was no scientific basis for the agency's conclusion, and the court can look at it. We'll direct the court both to the agency's analysis of greenhouse gas
emissions. If we were to reject your argument, maybe, I don't know if I'm repeating the same question, but if we were to reject your argument, the social carbon cost was an accurate way of doing this, what is the scientific basis to do this, to estimate the incremental cost?
The very minimum that they have to do is have some science. That's what CBD said. They have to have some science, and here they have none. If you look
not necessarily the economic cost, but the environmental effect. So separate and apart from the economic considerations, the statute requires there to be a hard look at the environmental effects. So it's undisputed that greenhouse gases have negative environmental effects. The issue is, did the agency take a hard look scientifically, setting aside the social cost of carbon analysis, scientifically, did the agency take a hard look at what those environmental effects would be? What science is there to support the conclusion that it's insignificant?
Judge Rawlinson, there is no science. The record directly contradicts the agency's determination of non-significance. I'll point to two sources in the record, Your Honor. The first is Dr. James Handen's report, one of the most prominent scientists on climate change. He says, first, we have to look at what is the current global concentration of greenhouse gas emissions? And he says it's unsafe. Current concentrations are unsafe. And in light of that, adding a massive amount, a quarter billion tons to already unsafe conditions will only worsen the already severe impacts of climate change by intensifying extreme wildfires and superstorms, and is not consistent with restoring the planet's energy balance. So that's the science that's in the record. Directly contradicts the non-significance determination.
But didn't they acknowledge that? I mean, they acknowledged that fires were likely to increase, environmental harms were likely to increase, droughts were likely to increase. So I don't understand that. If we were to agree with you and send this back to the agency, what would the agency do? What would they do differently here?
Your Honor, I'm going to try and reserve some time for rebuttal. So I'd like to respond to your question and then cover one more issue and then reserve time for rebuttal. So what the point that you're making, Your Honor, is a good one. The EA says, and I quote, continued greenhouse gas emissions will lead to severe, pervasive, and irreversible harm to people in the environment. That's what Dr. Hansen said. That language cannot be squared with the FONSI's determination that these impacts won't be significant. We submit to the court that severe, pervasive, and irreversible harm is not insignificant. That's our fundamental point. Your Honors, I'm going to rest on our briefs with respect to the discussion of coal train impacts and would just like to briefly in a minute cover remedy. And with respect to remedy, the presumptive remedy is vacator. That's what the court did in the Liberty Oil case. It should apply here. While the court has some discretion not to grant vacator, that the reasons for not granting vacator don't apply here for the reasons set forth in our brief. In short, the analysis of the DC Circuit in the Standing Rock case is on all fours with this case and should apply here. And I'd like to reserve the remainder of my time.
All right, thank you, counsel. Who's going first, Mr. Martin or Mr. Toth?
I will, Your Honor, Mr. Toth.
All right. So 7 minutes on the clock.
Respectfully, we split the time 13 and seven.
Oh, 13, I'm sorry. I was looking at the wrong one, Mr. Martin.
Not a problem. May it please the court, my name is Brian Toth from the Department of Justice, representing the federal defendants appellees, and I'm sharing time with Mr. Martin, counsel for intervener Signal Peak Energy. The district court correctly upheld the Department of the Interior's environmental assessment and its decision approving the mining plan for the Bull Mountains Mine number one. This is, just to put this a little in context, the lease for this coal was already challenged, was already upheld by the district court and on appeal by this court. So the intervener has a valid federal lease of federal coal. The action that's at issue here is Interior's approval of the mining plan that would allow the company to mine some federal coal in order to reach additional reserves of non-federal.
An additional 9 years, correct?
That's correct. So when my friend on the other side is talking about 240 million tons of emissions, that figure is for the entire 11 years. You have to actually step that back a little bit.
But was that total amount already analyzed previously in the mining approval, 240 million?
No.
Yeah, okay.
So you have that document.
It's a very significant expansion. It's a very significant expansion by any measure, is it not?
Well, it's significant not in terms of the NEPA issues.
That's what we're here for.
Right?
Can I ask you some questions about that? Because for me, it's not productive to talk about the social cost of carbon.
Sure.
I really want to talk about the other metric that the agency uses, and I can't figure it out. It seems to me that the agency determined that there was no need for an environmental impact statement here, and that the way this is quantified, the only thing I can find to quantify this is that this increase is going to be, it was deemed minor because it's approximately 44% of the annual single year global greenhouse gas emissions. Is that right? Over the life of the project, it was equal to 0.44%. Is that right?
For 1 year of global emissions.
Right.
The agency also put it in the context of annual national emissions and annual regional emissions.
Exactly, and on those, that's my follow-up question. So when we look at Montana, for the global emissions, the combustion was included, the emissions that will be generated by when the coal's actually burned. But for Montana and U.S., that was stripped out, and I don't understand that. If I bake it back in, it seems to me that the comparing Montana's emissions without this project and Montana's emissions with this project, there's an increase of about 45%.
Well,
I don't think the whole purpose of NEPA, of course, is to make sure the public understands the magnitude of this project. It took some work. And I don't understand, am I misreading that?
this is the nature of climate change. It's a global phenomenon. So the agency looked at it at these different scales. And it, when it was talking about the global emissions, it looked at it in the context of global emissions. And it actually built in a conservative assumption by combining the total 11 and a half years worth of emissions and comparing.
Well, but I think Judge Kristen's question is, when you looked at, you compared it to, you looked at Montana, you didn't include the combustion that would happen in Japan. And I have the same question. Is that intentional? Because, I mean, are you making an argument that because that happens in Japan, it can't be attributed to Montana just because the coal came there? Or what was the rationale for that?
That appears to be the agency didn't say it expressly, but that's what I infer is the agency's reasoning for.
Well, that's part of the problem is the agency is required to show its work.
Right.
So that we know that the requisite hard look has been taken. And so I have the same concern is what was the metric that was used? What was the scientific basis, the formula? What scientist has put his or her imprimatur on this conclusion?
So there isn't, I mean, the state of the science, the EA explains in several points, is that there is not an ability to attribute incremental effects at the global scale, or even at the local scale, to individual emitters.
That's an ipsy dixy. Is there a scientist who says that? Normally, when we have these cases, we have reports from scientists or scientific journals or something that we can refer to confirm the rulings that are made by the conclusions that are made by the agency. And this is just a flat out statement with nothing, no scientific proof behind it. And that's the difficulty. Setting aside the social cost of carbon issue, I have been accustomed to seeing some scientific backup for the statements that are made by the agency.
So I'll point you to Appendix D for the science on climate change. There's abundant science cited, not for that particular proposition you're questioning me on.
Well, that's the question. Where is it that it says that where's the science that says we can't do this?
So the citations to the EA are at 135 and 242 and 257 of the record. They don't cite particular scientific studies.
Right, that's the agency saying it, but they're not citing any scientific studies or any scientific backup or proof or anything. It's just a statement that's just floating out there.
So if I may, I want to point the court to three cases, two from this court, where similar statements have been made. Washington Environmental Council against Bellin, 732 F3rd, 1131, 1143. We cite that in our brief. It's a standing case, but the statement is made, this is 2013, there is limited scientific capability in assessing, detecting, or measuring the relationship between a certain greenhouse gas emission source and localized climate impacts in a given region.
2013 case?
Yep,
yes.
8 years ago.
Yes. So also 2013, Wild Earth Guardians against Jewel from the DC Circuit made a similar statement that's cited in our brief. And Barnes against DOT from this court from 2011, a case involving an environmental assessment prepared by the Department of Transportation for an airport expansion, says that because the effects of greenhouse gases on climate change, because it's a global problem, a discussion in terms of percentages is therefore adequate under NEPA in the context of an EA. So I don't think this is a disputed proposition. I mean, I take it, my friend on the other side, and advocating the social cost of carbon is doing so because it is the only methodology that can analyze any sort of incremental change.
Counselor, there has to be some non-arbitrary alternative. There has to be something. If we're going to find it convincing and to meet the standard here, I think in terms of the magnitude of the, again, this is not disclosed.
But if there's no science, what are they supposed to do?
So my question was, if I could just finish it first, if I may, please, I want to make sure that I have these facts right. If I don't, honestly, I want you to correct me. But my understanding, when we compare this size of this project and the current total U.S. emissions compared to what we would have if this project goes forward, is that this project would represent 6% of total U.S. emissions. Is that right?
I don't believe that's correct. I think the calculation was totaling all the emissions for the life of the mine, that's 11 and a half years, 9 years beyond the no action, it would be 0.04%.
Yeah, Kelsey, that's when you stripped out the combustion. I put combustion back in so that we can compare apples to apples. And it seems to me that we have to be able to do that because you've acknowledged, the EA has acknowledged, the, certainly our court has acknowledged, this is a global problem. So I'm struggling even to just figure out the magnitude here. I'm struggling to understand the rationale for stripping out combustion.
From the U.S. comparison, I mean, I think
yes,
the
my
idea
problem of- is, my problem is this is a massive project. It is a little schizophrenic for us to have gone up, you know, for many years where there was debate about global warming. This is unique because there's no debate. The EA is very upfront about global warming being a problem, greenhouse gases contributing to the problem, and on it goes. You're clearly very well prepared and are aware of that. And it strikes me that there are reasons to not adopt social cost of carbon, but it looks like the agency has said yes, but this one domestic project is not going to be a big percentage of the global total, so we can go forward. I mean, let me ask it this way. Won't every domestic project, if we're talking about one domestic project, given this new metric that you've used, they will always be minor. They will always be approved. It's almost like there's no metric at all. Can you help me figure out what I'm missing here?
So I think it's not necessarily the issue of approval. It's the issue of whether these emissions are significant. And what I hear you struggling with is the threshold.
Thank you for your correction.
The threshold for determining when this quantity rises to the level of significance that requires an environmental impact statement. And I mean.
And I don't see that here. Where would that be?
So the environmental assessment is the best evidence, the discussion of greenhouse gases that we've been talking about, it's the best evidence in the record of the agency's explanation. And I think it's important to keep in mind the context. But I would urge the court, you know,
on the FONSI, if I could, just to, if you could help me catch up, on the FONSI, to find no significant impact, it seems to me that when I look, so what would be significant? What's minor? Minor is just this one measure that I started with, 0.44%. of the global greenhouse gas emissions. Is that right? Or did I miss some other metric you're using to indicate there's no significant impact because this impact was minor?
No, I think you've captured it. I would urge the court, you know, if this is the point that you were struggling with and you ultimately conclude that the Interior has not adequately explained its reasoning here, then the remedy would appropriately be a remand to the agency and not the preparation of an EIS from the outset, leaving that
But that's the point of an environmental impact statement, is to actually have the science to take a look at what's happening, give us the best prediction as a matter of science. So just sending it back to further explain something that is not really tethered to a scientific study or analysis would not, in my view, comply with NEPA.
Well, respectfully, you know, there is new direction within the executive branch on using, for example, the social cost of carbon.
Can I ask a question about that? Because either, I think this is your brief. Maybe it's the other appellees, but the cite to the 2016. Regulation, guidance for federal departments and agencies on consideration of greenhouse gas emissions. Was that operative? That was not operative at the time this project went forward, or was it?
So the 2016 order, not when it was originally approved, but because this was in litigation previously, the district court had remanded this once before. And so this current EA was prepared in 2018 after that direction was in place.
Okay, so what is the operative reg that replaced it, or was there no? When was the 2016 reg? I guess it's just guidance. When was that replaced with something? Because you say that it's now the guidance issued under the Obama administration, which seemed to suggest no EISs would be conducted in this situation. What was that replaced with in 2019? Or was there no operative guidance in place in 2018 when the new EA came out?
I apologize. I was confusing the executive orders with the Council on Environmental Quality's guidance. And currently, I don't believe there is applicable guidance. I have to get back to the court on that. I was referring more to the executive orders on the use of social cost of carbon, which the current
operator. Right. And the question, yeah, go ahead. Oh,
forgive me, I interrupted you, please.
Well, I'm just trying to find out what, assume that we set aside social cost of carbon. What are they supposed to do? And what I read is in 2016, what the guidance was from CEQ was for most federal agency actions, CEQ does not expect that an EIS would be required based solely on the global significance of cumulative impacts of greenhouse gas emissions. What I'm trying to figure out is, was that guidance in place in 2018? Because the footnote says that the Obama, that was from the Obama administration, but it says that that was later withdrawn and replaced with the 2019 draft NEPA guidance. I'm assuming the draft NEPA guidance in 2019, that couldn't be used because that would have been after this. So does that mean that the 2016 guidance was what was operative for the executive branch during the 2018 EA?
I believe that's correct. I also believe that the guidance was in draft form, and I apologize if I'm not 100% sure on this, but it may have been in draft form only, which is why we didn't rely on it in our brief.
What if we find, could you go back to remedies? If we're not convinced, and it's not about social cost, but this alternative metric strikes me as worrisome. And I clearly indicated they have a lot of problems with it. Could you speak to what the correct remedy would be if that's the, if that turns out to be the view of the court?
So I think it would be to hold the environmental assessment arbitrary, or the reliance on the environmental assessment here arbitrary and capricious.
That's the part I understand.
Yes, and remanding it to the agency to for further proceedings as appropriate. And that might include—
But not, so your position continues to be that a project of this magnitude could go forward without an environmental impact statement. You would have us remand without directing that an EIS be prepared, is that it?
And allowing the agency to make that decision now under current guidance, using the best methodology that it now chooses, you know, with the direction of the court's ruling, and making that call in the first instance to provide a more robust explanation, which could then be reviewed by the court. And at that point, if there's only one methodology that can be used or only one explanation, and it would have to be significant, then that's the appropriate direction. But I just don't think we're at that point yet.
I interrupted you.
No, no problem. But isn't our presumptive remedy vacatur?
The APA provides that the court may set aside an agency
under
action.
Under our precedent, isn't the presumptive remedy when there has been a failure to take the requisite hard look, isn't it vacatur?
I think that's right. I think the burden is on us or on the interveners to prove that vacatur is not warranted. What you could allow the district court to consider that. It's in the first instance. It's a fact-intensive inquiry. There's been no evidence taken on it. Yeah, the district court didn't rule on that issue. In the past, the district court has decided not to vacate the actual agency decision.
But we can make that ruling as well.
You could. You have authority to do that. I'm just suggesting a factual record might benefit the court.
All right. Thank you, counsel. All right, Ms. Martin.
Thank you, Your Honor. My name is John Martin, and I represent Signal Peak Energy. I'd like to, if I can, respond to some of the inquiries that were made by the court, specifically the question about what was done here to evaluate greenhouse gas emissions, global warming, those sorts of issues. With due respect, I think the administrative record in this case is replete with science, with discussion, with consideration of all of these issues. First,
could you give us ER sites? I'm ready with my pen.
Indeed, I should. I would first.
The science.
First on the science, Appendix D of the ER and Volume 2 at pages 217 to 224. And let me also add that this is based on a very conservative quantification. I think we've all talked about how we compared 11 and a half years of greenhouse gas emissions to an annual greenhouse gas emissions globally. And so it's a very conservative estimate. And I'll talk more about that when we talk about
the... Could I interrupt you on that point, please? Because I'm finding this is very helpful to me. This is the gist of the problem for me. But the measurement you're talking about now included a global, the global greenhouse gas emissions, and it includes combustion, right?
I believe that's correct.
But combustion's not included when the project is quantified on the state level or the national level. Why is that?
Well, Your Honor, to be sincere about this, I'm not sure that I understand, you know, how it is that we could evaluate greenhouse gas emissions, except to the extent that there are greenhouse gas emissions from combustion. And it was my understanding. Well, that
exactly.
That
and the combustion is stripped out of when we compare Montana's greenhouse gas emissions currently to what it would be with this project, I think this would be 45% increase for just Montana. And I think it would represent 6% of our nation's total greenhouse gas emissions. And I think that the combustion stripped out, I assume that's because, you know, the coal's going to be burned overseas. But if that's the case, I can't reconcile it with the acknowledgement, which everybody seems to accept, that this is a global problem. So why is combustion stripped out?
Well, and Your Honor, I think the reason why we look at it as a global issue is because that's exactly what it is. And if we do a comparison for a local emission sort of thing, it's not particularly meaningful.
Well, then why do they do it? I actually follow your argument that the global number is the correct way to do it, but then I'm confused as to why you changed it. Is it because they were worried that this would make residents in Montana concerned or something? Because, I mean, you're right that it's the global number that matters, but you do that correctly on the global basis, but then on the national basis and the local basis, I mean, why are you even running national and local numbers and comparisons at all? Because everybody seems to acknowledge those are immaterial to global warming because it's a global problem.
And Your Honor, I'm not going to fault OSM for being overly inclusive about their analysis. Perhaps they felt it was a quantitative sort of comparison that might be useful in evaluating this project. But if we're talking about greenhouse gas emissions, that is a global phenomenon.
Right, and so the problem that you've got by measuring any domestic project against a global standard is that it's always gonna be minor. And that's why I'm looking for a metric that it allows the public to quantify. I think that's why they're very clearly why they're looking at Montana and our national contribution to this global problem. Hence my question, how can we call it minor? What's the reason for calling it minor when this would be 45% of Montana's total contribution to our global problem, and it would represent 6% of our nation's total contribution? Those sound like really big numbers to me, and that's why we're looking, you know, for science, for some kind of a quantification.
And Your Honor, I think that is contained in the discussion in Appendix D and the other parts of the administrative record.
Well, counsel, I'm there. I'm at Appendix D, page 217 to 224. So point me specifically to the scientific language that will convince us that the characterization of this as minor is supported by the science. Where can
Your
I look
Honor,
in those pages to have that science reflected?
Your Honor, with apology, I don't have that in front of me, and I'd be happy to supply a letter for the specifics. But
well,
let me say that
this is the time for you to persuade us about your case, and you pointed us to this in the record. So it would be helpful if we could get that now.
Well, Your Honor, there are discussions of the phenomenon of global warming and the consequences thereof. My recollection is that we talked about wildfires, that there was a discussion about rising seas. Those sorts of issues were discussed. And in fact, there is
an evaluation. When you say we, who are you including?
I'm sorry, I should be more precise. OSM, the Office of Surface Mining, Reclamation, and Enforcement. OSM did consider these phenomena. They did exactly what the appellants would have the agency do. In fact, if we look at this administrative record, what OSM did in this instance is they actually did an evaluation of social cost of carbon. They looked at two different computations, and after looking at it closely, after considering, after looking at that calculation, the agency said it was not helpful to its decision. That's
agreed.
Well within the rule of reason.
Agreed, but that separate and apart from the social cost of carbon is the problem.
And there, I think, the qualitative evaluation that was conducted, as I say in Appendix D, is precisely the sort of thing that an agency has the latitude to do.
What scientific study was quoted within those pages?
Your Honor, I cannot, and I apologize, off the top of my head, I cannot recall all of the science.
Mr. Martin? Mr. Martin, I've read those pages. I'm going to read them again. I appreciate you pointing them out, but I told you at the top of your argument, I got my pen. Is there anything else? Do you want to point us to any other place in the record that would help us to understand why or how the agency deemed this no significant impact?
Your Honor, I think that's the basis of it, and I think it's well within the parameters that are espoused by Lands Council. Your Honor, could I have a moment?
Yes, please, wrap up.
Okay. Your Honor, I would submit that if one were to balance the harms in terms of the remedy afforded here, it would be devastating to Signal Peak and devastating to the community for the court to enter an order of vacature. We submit that Monsanto requires that we balance the harms, that the court balance the harms before something like that could be entered as an order. Judge Malloy rejected the plaintiff's, in this case, the appellant's position on that subject matter in the past. And if there is consideration of vacature, we submit that it ought to be remanded to the district court for fact finding. Thank you, Your Honor. And
you,
we would ask, obviously, that the court affirm Judge Malloy's decision. Thank you.
Thank you, counsel. Rebuttal.
Thank you, Your Honors. I'm going to start with where we left off. The question of Appendix D, and the court can review Appendix D, it's in the record. The important thing to note about Appendix D is that it's entirely untethered to the significance determination in this case, the insignificance determination, and entirely untethered to the greenhouse gas emissions from this project, the 250 million tons of greenhouse gas emissions from this project. It's not mentioned there at all. The only place that where there's a discussion of how significant this 250 million tons of greenhouse gas emissions occurs in the EA at page ER135. And there the agency does, all it does is say 0.4% of global, therefore minor. And that is, they cite no scientific authority in that analysis. They repeat a similar analysis in the FONSI at ER67. Again, zero citation, actual scientific authority. And that's unlawful. I'll point the court to the CVD court decision at pages 120, 1224, and 1225. And there the court says, without some articulated criteria for significance in terms of contribution to global warming that is grounded in the record and available scientific evidence, the agency's bald conclusion that the mere magnitude of the percentage increase is enough to alleviate its burden to conduct a more thorough investigation cannot carry the day. And that's exactly what happened here. A couple of points briefly to respond to your question, Judge Kristen. You're exactly right. My calculations are that 250 million tons of greenhouse gas emissions are between 5 and 6% of global, of national emissions from the United States, which we submit as significant.
But that's over a 50, just so I can clarify in my own mind, that's over a 11 year period, right?
That's annual.
Yeah. The total emissions from the mine, 240 billion tons, which would be over 10 years, would constitute 5%, 5 to 6% of annual United
right.
States.
Right, okay, okay.
That's
okay.
Right. Another point of comparison, Your Honor, we pointed out in the record that the emissions from this mine, the annual emissions from this mine, are greater than the largest single source of greenhouse gas emissions in the United States. The largest coal plant in the United States wouldn't produce as many emissions as this mine in 1 year. We submit...
So, counsel, can I just ask you, do you think that the science setting aside social cost of carbon, do you think the science has advanced over the last 8 years since this court issued the Bellin case and the Barnes case, where we said you can't determine you can't determine an incremental cost of global warming? Do you believe that the science has advanced over the last 8 years that the agency actually would be able to do something on remand other than the social cost of carbon?
Yes, two responses, Your Honor. And the first one, you won't appreciate briefly, it's the social cost of carbon. The record bears that out. The second one I think is important, and that's Dr. Hansen's report. There he says the first place we have to look is whether or not we have a safe level of greenhouse gas emissions in the atmosphere, and we don't. Therefore, adding
problem with that is then we're going to the opposite extreme, because then we're going to require EISs anytime any carbon is emitted. So how do we crack this nut in a reasonable way?
Yeah, with respect, Your Honor, no. And that's the straw man argument that the other side has made. We're not making that. Given the unsafe levels, any large project like this, a project that's equivalent to the largest single source, should at least be considered significant. I'll point the court to this court's decision in the Blackwood decision, which was relied upon by CBD. And there the court was talking about adding sediment to a river that's already choked with sediment. And the court said specifically, the question isn't whether or not the other sources of sediment are bigger than the sources of sediment from this project. The question is what the total impact is. And that's the question here. When you have already unsafe levels and you add even more, another major source, that at least should be significant in addition to the social cost of carbon. Your Honors, my time is up.
Counsel, I just wanted to ask you one question. I thought Judge Nelson was talking about the cases that talk about the incremental cost, but that's not what my concern is. It's not the incremental cost, it's the environmental effects, which is different from the incremental cost of greenhouse gases. And we've set that aside because the social cost, we don't have to do an economic analysis, but we do have to under NEPA do environmental effects analysis. So that's the point that I'm curious about your addressing, as opposed to the incremental cost, that it's not of equal concern to me.
Yes, Your Honor, and that's correct. Setting entirely aside the social cost of carbon, the citation I made from CBD is that there has to be some articulated science-based standard for assessing significance. And here there's none. I direct the court to ER 135 and ER 67. There's no science supported, Your Honor. And that's what the agency has to do. They have to have some scientific basis for their significance conclusion. Thank you, Your Honor, for the time. If there are no further questions, appellants ask that the court reverse the district court.
Counsel, before we conclude, could you respond to opposing counsel's characterization of Baker Tour as being devastating to the project and devastating to the community?
Yes, 2 points, Your Honor. The actually, I think the best point is to respond by citing the Standing Rock decision. And there the court said that any adverse impacts of vacator will be minimized by prompt preparation of an EIS. So it's only temporary. And that's the important point. And I'll direct the court then to—
back up. How quickly can an EIS be done? I mean, in my experience, EISs generally take years. I mean, that's the whole problem here.
That's another non sequitur, prompt government preparation.
if I may, Your Honor, the prior administration had guidance saying that agencies should try to complete their EISs in 1 year. I'm not sure certain of the status. That's the goal here with the existing analyses the agency has done and a focused EIS on greenhouse gas emission impacts. We submit that it could be done more quickly. Final point on this with respect to Judge Rawlinson's question is that I'll direct the court to the League of Wilderness Defenders versus Connaughton decision. That's 752 Fed 3rd 755. And there the court said that a temporary loss of economic benefits does not outweigh permanent environmental impacts. And that's the case here. Vacator would be temporary, the impacts would be permanent, and therefore vacator is appropriate. Thank you, Your Honor.
All right, thank you. Thank you to all counsel for your helpful arguments on this challenging case. The case just argued is submitted for decision by the court. That completes our calendar for today. We are in recess until 9:30 a.m. tomorrow morning.
Thank you.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Thank you. All rise. This court for this session stands adjourned.